Just you got inspired? All we needed was the offertory.
Well, this is the whole, this is the section that gets out of order.
Right.
So this was, I did the whole thing, but I just put this part in here today.
Okay, but you got this different
Anne
from
asked,
this.
Anne asked me to put this one in here. This is... Isn't that the same text? That's where I took it from.
Okay. This is part of the same thing. This and this.
Right.
Hi, John.
Hi.
How are you? How are you?
Just...
Peachy?
Crabby shit today.
Oh, I'm glad to know that ahead of time. See the smiling face?
Yeah,
now
see
you
it.
Won't be so crabby, will really? Are you crabby?
Business has been changed.
Oh. You'll be fine.
Yep. I guess.
It'll be fine.
We got Are you ready to go?
I think so. Yeah, I think we don't need three of these out here, do we?
No, I don't know why there's so many.
This here, you can have this one.
Mine.
One's yours. Mine is marked with people. So I know who people are.
Where's the sunshine?
That's what I said. It's so dark in here today, even with all
the lights.
Lights
on up here.
That
needs the upstairs lights on.
Off your phone? It's in there, yes, it's in there. I didn't just double check it.
Turn off my watch. Otherwise, I'd answer.
You know what? I bet it's that one over there that doesn't have lock on the back.
Yeah.
It's right over there.
Just leave it.
The chair?
The chair that doesn't have
lock. There were chairs that
were here.
But now they were here because they have no backs.
And then I brought chairs from the boardroom and from all along that.
Because we didn't have enough.
Because we didn't have enough. But.
That's our own.
Nice ball. It was nice. I took pictures. Mindy is lighting the chalice. Please, no. I have to make it accessible.
It says
yes.
Please start.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is John DeGreve, and I'm the treasurer of this wonderful organization. Welcome to our service. Unitarian Universalism encourages open-ended search for meaning in life and a commitment to asking our values to shape our actions. We are a pluralistic religion that draws wisdom from many sources, and we welcome all of you into our beloved community. Of whatever age, race, class, ethnicity, physical ability, or sexual orientation, gender identity, or religious background. That's everybody. Everybody's welcome. We welcome especially those who are worshiping with us for the first time. Guests are welcome to participate in any activity in our community. The welcome team members are wearing green name badges and are ready to answer any questions you may have. Or, if you're new to the congregation, the pastoral care team members are wearing yellow name badges and are able to talk to you if you have a life transition or a need of assistance. We invite everyone to join us downstairs after service for coffee and snacks so that we can get to know you better. So thank you for being here today, and welcome.
Thank you, John. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
My name is Ann Herington. Many of you know me. I am a co-leader of our archives team, along with daughters Diane and Hannah. Diane is here today. Hannah is off traveling. I want to take a moment for the spotlight just to introduce the archives team as it currently is. And if you are here and can wave your hand or stand up. That way we can identify those of you who are on the team. The team meets on Thursdays currently from 10 to 1 approximately. We are looking to add some times for those that can't be here during the day, which is quite often, but we're trying to develop some new times so that people can participate with us and join in our fun. So, with that, I want to introduce the members of the team, myself, Diane, Molly Tigland, Cliff Day, Katie Reinhart, Isabel Dawson, Jerry Walla, who participates mostly from afar when we need him to, Kathy Weideman, and newest member, Mindy Pace. So that is our team. You'll learn more about what we do in this service in telling our stories. But I want to welcome you this morning.
Oh.
Once again, good morning. My name is Molly Tegland. I'm a member of the Archives Crew. Story. Dictionary.com offers this definition. Story. A narrative, either true or fictitious, in prose or verse, designed to interest, amuse, or instruct the hearer or reader. All of us have stories. Institutions have stories, too. Our archives room holds the stories of this church, going back to its founding in 1868 and earlier. There was a song written in the 1980s by folk singer Mike Jones titled The Storyteller. It was repurposed by the History Press as a poem, which perfectly represents the art of storytelling. Part of the poem is as follows. A story well told can lift up your hearts and help you forget all your sorrows. It can give you the strength and the courage to stand and face all your troubles tomorrow. For there's wisdom and wit, beauty and charm, there's laughter, and sometimes there's tears. But when the story is over and the spell it is broken, you'll find that there's nothing to fear. My stories were learned in my grandparents' house, where their grandparents also had heard them. They were given as payment by traveling folk for a warm place to lay down their burdens. My stories are ageless. They never grow old. With each telling, they are born anew. And when my story is ended, I'll still be alive in the tales that I've given to you.
And now if you could join us in lighting the chalice, the words are up on the screen and they're also in your order of service. We light this chalice for all who are here and all who are not, for all who have ever walked through our doors, for those who may yet find this spiritual home, and for those we can't even yet imagine, for each of us and for us all, may this flame burn warm and bright. And now please rise as you are willing and able for our opening song, 1003. It's in your teal hymnal. And this one has a little bit of direction, so we're gonna sing through the whole song one time. And then after that, you get to pick your own adventure. So you can pick one of the lines in the song and just sing it over and over. Gates is gonna give us one of these on the last time through. And choir members are gonna pick different things, so you might hear some other people singing. Great, please stand if you're willing and able.
Where do we come from?
Good job, everybody. Sorry, just one second. Right now, we would like to greet each other in our mix, so please stand and find someone that you maybe normally don't talk to. Welcome everybody today.
You can come up here.
If you could head back to your seats, thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Hello, my name is Tiffany Kaldenbach, and I help out downstairs with Ari. And since Ken is not here today, I am doing the Words for All Ages. I'm going to be reading a story called Tale of Two Beasts. And the first part of the story is from the little girl's perspective. And then the second part of the story, it'll be told again from this little creature's perspective. There are two sides to every story. And then there's the truth. Mark Twain. I was walking home from Grandma's house through the deep, dark woods when I spied a strange little beast. He was stuck up in a tree and whining sadly. So I decided to rescue him. Meep. I will call you Fang, I told him, and wrapped him up warmly in my scarf and carried him safely home. I gave him a lovely bath and a gorgeous new hat and sweater and a delicious bowl of fresh nuts. I made him a beautiful house and gave him Lord Rex to play with. I took him out for long walks to keep him fit and healthy. And I showed him off to all my friends who loved him nearly as much as I did. But for some reason, the little beast did not look very happy. In fact, he was looking rather hot. I hope he's not sick. And opened the window to cool him down. But then something terrible happened. He threw off his clothes and leapt out of the window and ran away as fast as he could back into the deep, dark woods. I wanted to go out and look for him, but Mama had other plans. Dinner, blah. Bath time, ugh. Bedtime, grrr. I couldn't sleep. I missed the little beast and wondered if I would ever see him again. But then a small furry shadow appeared at the foot of my bed. The strange little beast had returned. He seemed quite pleased to see me, and I began to think that maybe, just maybe, he wasn't that strange after all. I wonder why he came back. The terrible beast. So this is from the creature's perspective. I was hanging from my favorite tree, singing happily to the birds when I was ambushed by a terrible beast. She growled at me and tied me up and carried me off to her secret lair. She made me disgustingly clean and dressed me up in a ridiculous hat and sweater and tried to make me eat squirrel food. She kept me in a tiny box with nothing for me to do and nowhere for me to hang from. Sorry. She made me walk backwards and forwards and backwards again for no reason whatsoever. She showed me off to a herd of even wilder beasts who were just as terrible as she was. I had enough. I made a cunning plan and put it straight into action. It says A plus B equals freedom. Free once more. I raced back to the deep dark woods before the terrible beast could catch me. It was peaceful in the deep dark woods. A bit too peaceful, perhaps. And also a bit wet. In weather like this, one could do with a warm hat. I snuck back over to retrieve it under the cover of darkness. The terrible beast was waiting for me. She seemed quite pleased to see me. And I began to think that maybe, just maybe, she wasn't that terrible after all. And now, if the kids will come downstairs and we can talk more about stories and how to tell them in a kind way, respecting the other person's perspective.
I want to give you just a little pre-information. There will be a slideshow. It may or may not actually coincide with exactly the points in the story, but you'll get the idea as I go along and watching the captions. We are kicking off our summer theme of storytelling this week. Stories aren't just for writers or the elderly, or for children at bedtime. Stories are magic. They can transport us to different worlds and show us the lives of those different from us.
They can teach us life lessons and give us a sense of hope or calm for the future. Stories can be written or displayed or spoken. Storytelling, specifically the spoken word, is an integral part of history. Histories, values, and religious rituals were passed on through generations by telling stories. Eventually, methods to preserve those stories, like writings, drawings, and photographs, were developed. These methods allowed for more accurate views of history. And lucky for us, our UU congregation was blessed with our very own first historian that we're aware of, Betty Gorshi, my mother, Diane's grandmother. She helped found the archives team along with Carolyn Owen Toll, wife of our then minister, Reverend Tom Owen Toll, and wrote two history books for the church. She is one of the main sources, or should we say, collector of stories for this service today. We've had a lot of changes in the last 15 to 20 years, and it's come to our attention that some of you may not know the stories of this place and who we are as a congregation. So today, we'd like to be your storytellers. I'd like to start with a little exercise. Stories should evoke images and feelings. So to best focus, I invite you to close your eyes for a moment. Think about coming to church on a Sunday morning. Walk through the doors. Greet your friends. Head toward the sanctuary. Find your seat. Take a moment. Breathe. When you're ready, open your eyes. For many, you probably pictured our current space. Did any of you picture someplace other than our current building? The pictures on the screen show our first building, the little chapel, which was in the same location as our second building on 9th and Perry, which later became 10th and Perry. The second building was a brick building with First Unitarian Church inscribed at the top. The little chapel was raised for the second building to be constructed. The inside of the sanctuary looked a bit different. You might notice the organ at the front or the auditorium-type seating. If those seats seem familiar to some of you, you may have seen them either sitting here long ago or downstairs when you go down the back staircase. Maybe our current sanctuary was what you pictured, just looking a little bit different because it had those chairs in it. They are the chairs some of us used to sit on for every Sunday service here. But now the chairs are the ones that we use for coffee hour. So most of you will probably recognize those white chairs. Going back to your image of Sundays, if our current space is what you pictured, were there certain elements that stood out in your mental image? There are actually small pieces of history displayed here. The stained glass window, for example, the one at the back, as you walk in the sanctuary doors and look straight ahead, was from the second building. These behind me were designed to replicate the originals from that
glass that was in that second building at 10th and Perry. Maybe you pictured the stand where you get your order of service as you come in the door. That was used during child dedications with the silver christening bowl that was a gift from one of our ministers when his wife died. Perhaps you recognize the boat, as it is called. Its real name is a baldachin, and it was built to hide the sound system and stereos. This is only a sampling of the objects that tell the story as we have known for the last 155 years. There are many more. Some exist in the form of a photo or a document preserved for posterity and protected from bright light and even greasy fingers. That's an important part for archival storage and for preservation. We actually have white gloves that we wear often when we look at something really, really old. The archives display case, which is downstairs in the lower level by the lounge doors, holds a small picture display entitled Things Seen and Unseen Around the Church. It too provides another glimpse into a few more things seen and unseen that make up our story. And there are even more of the unseen ones in the archives room just beside that display case. And if you haven't been there and you want to see it sometime, I'm more than happy to introduce you to it. It was never the intention of my mother, Betty Gorshy, to compile our history when in 1993 she wrote the book entitled Unitarian Church, Davenport, Iowa, for 125 years, A Place to Grow. Or the next one, Bits and Pieces, 10 years later. Her reason was simple. As she began to look through all of the things that existed and the articles that she found about history here and in our former spots, she said this, quote, "If I didn't write it, who would? The stories live in the pages of these books and beg us to keep telling our stories for the future generations of this place. There will be copies of these available if you would like to purchase them. And later on, you'll understand why that might be helpful to us. Diane will share that a little bit later. You already know my name, so I'm not going to share that piece of it, but I am a member of pastoral care, so I am moving on to the joys and sorrows that we share as we are here together. We come together as a community to share the joys, the concerns, the sorrows, and the milestones of our lives. At this time of sharing, we take a moment to read your entries from the Book of Joys and Concerns, which is located outside the doors at the entrance of the sanctuary. Thea Sadlick writes, "It was a joy to see so many old UU friends and some former staff members at Sue Whitty's celebration of life yesterday. It was also sad to say farewell to our beautiful friend, Sue. And if you were here, or if you weren't, this sanctuary was full. And there, it was such a bright day with the sunflowers. So, yes, Sue was an integral part of who we are." From Emily Smith, "It was a joyous memorial service for Sue Whitty yesterday. The church was full. The service was led and run by women. I am proud to consider the women of this congregation." From John DeGreve, "Jan and I celebrated our 56th wedding anniversary yesterday." Woo-hoo!
and from Isabel Dawson. To see UU Friends support, it's a joy to see UU Friends support Genesius Guild. Thanks for coming.
Are there any joys and concerns that were shared online? Nothing. Thank you.
For what has been shared and for what remains in the quiet sanctuary of our hearts, we are grateful. We continue with words from Khalil Gibran. When you are joyous, look deep into your heart and you shall find it is only that which has given you sorrow that is giving you joy. When you are sorrowful, look again in your heart, and you shall see that in truth, you are weeping for that which has been your delight. Some of you say, joy is greater than sorrow, and others say, nay, sorrow is the greater. But I say unto you, they are inseparable. Together they come, and when one sits alone with you at your board, remember that the other is asleep upon your bed. Verily, you are suspended like scales between your sorrow and your joy. Only when you are empty are you at standstill and balanced. Let us become aware of the energy that brings us together here in beloved community. As we share a time of silent meditation, may we open our minds and hearts to a place of quiet and engage in silent prayer for the healing of pain and the balm of love. When the musical meditation begins, you are invited to come forward in silence and light a candle. Thank you.
This congregation is a theologically diverse religious community with membership open to all who accord with our principles, mission, and vision. Our congregation is entirely self-governed by the democratic process. One of the privileges of our free church tradition is to provide all of the financial support for our many ministries from among ourselves. Generosity, therefore, is one of the spiritual values that we recognize as central to our personal and our institutional well-being. This month, we are sharing the undesignated plate offering with who? With Environmental Justice? Perfect. So if you didn't get that, we're sharing half of the offering this month, essentially with the people who have been displaced from the building collapse downtown. So please be as generous as you are able. We invite you to participate in the blessing of giving as the ushers come among you to accept the gifts of the congregation. The gifts of time and treasure that you give to this congregation, with sincere gratitude, we thank you.
Thank you.
physical objects aren't the only pieces of our story that live on. We have many traditions here that have produced grand stories for people to tell. At most church social gatherings, it was almost expected that we would serve Grover's Punch. Starting in the early 1960s, church member and retired bachelor Grover Vonderheide chaired the social committee of the church. He was cook extraordinaire and loved to plan big church dinners and serve them with style. He would assemble his harem, as he called the women who were regulars he counted on to help. This committee also served wedding receptions and gatherings following memorial or funeral services. Grover discovered a punch recipe, which to this day is known to those old timers as Grover's Punch. Recently, it was requested for two of our most recent celebration of life services, including at Sue's yesterday. You have to taste it to really know how good it is. You can ask Joe Macheco, who asked for seconds yesterday after Sue's service. A picture of Grover and his harem is seen in the display case downstairs and is also in the slideshow. If you're lucky enough today, you might even get a taste of some of that Grover's Punch. There wasn't much left, but we'll do our best to give you a small taste. UUs used to gather to tell stories in various social groups, like Triple E's, which was everyone enjoys, everything everyone enjoys, or UFO, Unitarian Fun Organization. I remember going to Triple E's with my grandparents at the Hy-Vee right over here. Members told stories while playing on our UU baseball team, the UU Knights, and while working at the coffee house or the rummage sale, now known as the second time around sale. One lesser known story is that back in the 1890s, and this story stars Reverend Arthur Judy, who wanted to establish a clubhouse of sorts for the young people of his congregation to gather for stories, games, and outdoor activities. Members of the Unity Club here agreed to help Reverend Judy in a substantial way, and the ideal location was found near what is now Vandeveer Park. The estate was previously owned by farmer S.D. Brewster, who actually requested that he would be paid for his land in gold. The plans grew, and people outside the congregation asked to be allowed to join as well. In July of 1891, the property was purchased and the Outing Club was established. So it was actually established and founded by UUs. Stories are our way of letting the memories important to us live on forever. The best part of stories, though, are the people that tell them. The stained glass windows, the seats, the events, none of it really matters unless there are people like you to pass on the stories. You are what keeps it going. You get to tell the stories of this place. You are the stories of this place. You are the history, the present, and the future. For example, we're going to do a little activity. If you're online, you can acknowledge yourself in the comments. But if you have ever served on the Board of Trustees, we would like you to please stand and be recognized. So anytime if you've ever served on the board, please stand. Thank you all so much for your efforts in serving on the board. We recognize your time and your talents. Next, we would like to recognize all of you and your time and your stories and your memories that you've made here. So online, you can leave a comment of how long you've been a member or a friend of the church. If you're with us in person, we'd like you to stand if you've been a member or friend with us for 5 years or less. Paces. Beautiful, thank you. Please stay standing. Please stand if you've been a member with us or friend for 10 years or less. Now, please stand if you've been a member or friend for 15 years or less. I know some of you are having to do some math in your head a little bit. But please stay standing. 20 years or less. Okay. 25 years or less. And now, if you've been a member or friend with us for more than 25 years, please stand. Perfect. Thank you, everybody, for all of your time and your memories. You all are the reason why our stories continue. You are the reason why we have made the archives team in general, so that we can continue to tell our stories, to tell your stories, to tell the stories of this place. We all together get to tell and be the story of this place that we call our spiritual home. So now, if you could please remain standing, or stand if you haven't already, as we start our closing song, which is number 128 in the Gray Hymnal, For All That Is Our Life. Can be seated. Please join us in extinguishing the chalice. The words are in your order of service and also up on the screen. We have basked in the warmth and beauty of this flame and this community. As the chalice flame is established, let us carry its glow within. Let us kindle new sparks within these walls and beyond. For our closing today, we'd like to present you with a project. We, as the archives team, would like to write a volume 2 of the Bits and Pieces book, a collection of stories about the Unitarian Church celebrating 135 years as it was completed in 2003. Now it's been 20 years since then, and we have so many more stories to tell. We'd like you to share any stories and or pictures you have with us. You can email them to our archives email, which is archives@uucqc.org, or you can leave them in the archives mailbox, or you can hand it to one of our team members. But we would like kind of this project to begin starting now so that we can compile the stories over the last 20 years, or maybe even longer if you didn't get a chance to submit your stories from before. So we would like to submit any stories, photos, anything that you have memories of the church. This project can only be successful with your help, so we thank you in advance for sharing your stories. And now we'll leave you with our closing words, which is a Native American proverb that was introduced to us by a previous DRE and a dear personal friend, Dino Hayes. Tell me a fact and I'll learn. Tell me a truth and I'll believe. But tell me a story and it will live in our hearts forever.
Thank you all, and I don't remember my price thing. I'll have to check, but if you're interested in these, catch me downstairs at coffee hour, and I will make sure that you can get your hands on either one or both of the books. Thank you for joining us today.